Let's give it up for Emily.
Thank you. Thank you. How many of you have been to a museum and after 5 minutes you get museum fatigue, which is a very common condition, and go to the gift shop? Yes, lots of people. My name's Emily Kotecki. I'm a museum educator at the North Carolina Museum of Art. And I'm here to tell you how to beat museum fatigue. When I plan programs for high school and college students, I think of three C's: comfort, confidence, and choice. Comfort being, where are the bathrooms? Where can I sit down and where can I get some water? Once you have those basic elements, and I can't control those in all museums, you can have confidence. Confidence to look at art. It seems obvious, but a lot of people don't know how and think there's a right answer. There is not a right way to look at art. And then you have the choice to decide whether or not you like it. But before you like it, you have to look at it. A survey found that museum visitors spend an average of 3 seconds looking at art. The artist spent a lot more time making that painting, so there might be something to look at. And another survey found that museum visitors spend 15 seconds looking at the Mona Lisa. And it might be because they're stuck in a mob and can't get out. But today, we're gonna break some world records and look at art for longer than 3 seconds. So we're gonna look at a few things coming up, and what we're gonna do, the first thing that you would do when you go to the North Carolina Museum of Art, which is free, is you get really close to a painting. Make the guards a little uncomfortable. Don't tell them I told you that, but get really close. This is a detailed image of texture. Texture being, how does the paint look on the canvas? Is there motion? Is it smooth? Is it gloppy and thick? And how does that affect how the painting looks overall? This is another detailed photograph of color. When you look at color and you look for clues, what kind of energy is coming out of that painting? And once you follow color, it'll kind of fall, your eye will follow throughout the canvas. Now, when you also are really close and the guard is asking you to leave, try to resist that urge. And you're gonna get even closer and try to look for a few notes of detail. A lot of time when you go up to a painting, you don't get close enough to see what's in the background. Because just as the foreground is important, the artist is putting things back there to balance the canvas. So it's as important to get really close, and we'll see in a second where these figures are when you step back a little bit. And that is the next way that you're going to look at a painting, is to step back about a foot so that the whole piece is in your view. That little bit of texture is just right here. So you can see if you step back, you see how the texture is causing these waves to shoot up. This is a piece by Monet, how the rock is looking jagged, how the light is affecting the rock. And you'd really only see that once you step close and then back. That detail we saw with color, right there. And you're gonna let that silver bar lead your eye up the canvas, across the top. You're gonna see this red like beam of light coming across, and see that red is used across the whole canvas. And you're really only get a chance to see that if you start fresh, move back. That detail we saw, it's right here. And if you first stepped up, what you'd probably see is that huge cow head and that big rib and this snake thing, whatever that is. But there are details happening in the back that affect how you look at the piece as a whole. And you might miss it if you don't step back, and then a little further back, and then way back. You're talking maybe halfway across the gallery, bump into some visitors, make the guards a lot more comfortable. Look at how it frames the piece. And you don't have to look at these things in a silo. You can look at texture and color at the same time. But now that you've seen this whole Monet piece, you're looking at texture, how the frame is putting it together, you might see details you wouldn't have recognized had you not stepped back. Now, just as artists make choices, our exhibition designers make choices as to how they hang the works in the gallery. So that when you step back, you see how the exhibition designer caused a conversation between these pieces. They want you to look not only in a silo, but all together as a whole. You can see that in this contemporary gallery, it's not framed, but these are framed. And this is in an era of Flemish, in the Flemish galleries. So what else was happening in the Flemish era when the painting was happening? What were the landscapes like? What were the themes that you might see? You'd only get a chance if you really step back to look. And the space is there. The museum is wide open for you to walk around. Now this piece is upside down. It's not by accident, it's on purpose. And the best way to look at it is to turn yourself upside down. Because once you turn your whole body upside down, everyone's turning their heads upside down, awesome, you'll get to see this texture and this color, because that's how the artist painted it, was upside down. So you're putting yourself in the eye of the artist. With figure sculptures, it's fun to try to make eye contact. you might end up squatting down on this corner of a gallery because you're trying to make eye contact with Venus Italica. You might end up on the other side of the room because you're trying to make eye contact with that person, and she's looking up, so actually you really can't make eye contact. But your head is going to look up. Now, besides just looking at pieces, you can start using your imagination. Imagine if you were that guy over on the side pouring out dead fish, and there's this seal trying to catch that squirrel, and this dead deer is kind of smelling up the place. What would it be like to be in there and smell all this dead animal? It wouldn't probably be very good. Another way is to imagine what it sounds like. When I look at this piece, I think of summer North Carolina thunderstorms and that big pounding of thunder and that clap of lightning and that urgency you feel when you see really dark clouds because you want to run for cover fast. So when you're putting all these together, you're looking at it, you're turning your body upside down, you can make your own opinion. I heard this little boy tell his friend to this painting, "That does not look like a person talking to their cat." And I was looking at it, okay. And the little girl said, "Well, it doesn't matter. It does to me. And it's all about perspective." And I was like, "Yeah, girl, that's right. You're only like 9 years old and you get it." The point is, when you look from different perspectives and you crouch down and you stand on your tippy toes, you won't end up like these guys. So hopefully by these strategies, by looking at art in a different way, you can engage with the art. You can talk to the person you're with. You can make a new friend. It's a great way to pick up somebody. You can start looking at art and have this engaging conversation so the next time that you're standing in front of the Mona Lisa, you're standing there for longer than 15 seconds looking at texture and color and line, and not because you're stuck in the mob, but because you really enjoy it, and then you can go to the gift shop. Thank you.